So I'm very pleased now to introduce our keynote speaker, Dr. Jonathan Haidt. When I thought about what would be most helpful and of the most interest to us at this point in time, the work of Jonathan Haidt was at the absolute top of my list. His message couldn't be more timely. The title of his address today is, "What is Happening to Our Country? How Psychology Can Respond to Political Polarization, Incivility, and Intolerance." So I can't wait to hear the answer. A social psychologist whose research focused on the intuitive foundations of morality, its variations among cultures, and its developmental course. Dr. Haidt is the Thomas Cooley Professor of Ethical Leadership at NYU's Stern School of Business. His extensive research focuses on moral emotions, from disgust, shame, and vengeance to admiration, awe, and moral elevation. This research has provided a resounding platform for people to understand and respect the moral motives of people with whom they disagree. Dr. Haidt identifies care, fairness, liberty, loyalty, authority, and sanctity as the six values that form the baseline of any moral system. Psychologists like Dr. Jonathan Haidt are effectively beginning to shed light on the scientific foundations of our moral beliefs. Dr. Haidt has successfully applied and extended his core specialty of moral psychology into the fields of business ethics and viewpoint diversity in academy. As a leading member of a new generation of psychologists applying the insights of evolutionary theory to morality, he's received an impressive amount of global recognition for his forward thinking. Foreign Policy magazine named him one of the top 100 global thinkers in 2012 for revealing the psychology of partisanship. He has led global intellectual trends by being named one of the 65 world thinkers of 2013 by Prospect magazine, one of the top 100 global thought leaders by the Gottlieb Duttweiler Institute 2 years in a row, and one of the 100 most influential people in business ethics by Ethisphere. A prolific writer and speaker, Dr. Haidt has authored more than 100 academic articles, and his work has been cited over 21,000 times by, according to Google Scholar. His persuasive and inspiring TED Talks on political psychology and the causes of America's political polarization have been viewed by close to 4 million people. Dr. Haidt is the author of The Happiness Hypothesis, a fascinating book relating modern and ancient ideas about happiness and the inner working of the human behaviors that affect it. He also authored the New York Times bestseller, The Righteous Mind, Why Good People Are Divided by Politics and Religion, a book that I read just after I finished reading The Independent Review. That's true. And then I called him. So it's my great pleasure that I ask you to join me in welcoming Dr. Jonathan Haidt.
Thanks so much. Okay. Well, thank you, Susan. Thank you for your leadership in this difficult time. And thanks for giving me the opportunity to address our field. Good evening, my fellow psychologists. So we come together at a time that is confusing and alarming, not just in America, but in many of the Western democracies. At a time like this, it's quite comforting to realize that people have been here before. We're not the first. And they've left us some guidance. So here's William Butler Yeats writing in the wake of the carnage of the First World War and just at the start of the Irish War of Independence. And he says, "Turning and turning in the widening gyre, the falcon cannot hear the falconer. Things fall apart, the center cannot hold. Mere anarchy is loosed upon the world. The blood-dimmed tide is loosed, and everywhere the ceremony of innocence is drowned. The best lack all conviction, while the worst are full of passionate intensity." Now, I'm going to focus on the two lines that I've underlined there, because if you look closely at the poem, what Yeats is basically doing is saying that political events, things falling apart in the world, are related to moral psychology. Now, normally, poets celebrate passionate intensity, right? But Yeats realizes that it's passionate intensity that is causing chaos, anarchy. It has a very dark side. And in my talk today, I'm going to say exactly why that is so true. So let's review the last 3 years. Let's review how it is that things seem to have fallen apart in America. Now, at first, it seemed like it was a distinctively American problem. We had this bizarre thing where the federal government shut down because our Congress could not reach agreement on how to pass a budget. So it seemed then as though our politics, which had been growing worse, was falling apart. The following year, we had the awfulness of watching unarmed black men killed by police officers, and that led to protest movements and to the perception that race relations in our country were falling apart. The next year, we had populist uprisings on the right and the left, and the norms of our normal political life seemed changed forever. Our politics, again, seemed to be falling further and further apart. The following year, this year, we were treated to yet more horrors of unarmed black men being killed by police officers, and this time of police officers being killed by armed black men. So in so many ways, it seems things are falling apart. All of this happening, of course, just weeks after our worst mass shooting ever. Mere anarchy is loosed upon the world. The blood-dimmed tide is loosed. I think most Americans are feeling that to some extent. But only recently have we realized that it's not just America. It's happening in many European countries as well. There's some sort of a problem with democracy. There's something we're not understanding about democracy. So 2015 began and ended with horrific terrorist attacks in Paris. In between, the Syrian civil war got worse and worse, and millions of people tried to flee, many of them basically walking up into the heart of Europe. These events, combined with other problems in the EU and the Euro crisis, led to the rise of right-wing populist parties in many European countries. This graph in the New York Times shows the rise in red of right-wing populist parties all across Europe. Throughout the spring, people around Europe were asking, why is Europe so fed up? What is going on in Europe? And all of this was before Britain voted to leave the EU. So even in Europe, things fall apart. The center cannot hold. If Scotland now secedes from the UK, then there'll be no more UK. It'll just be England again. And if France and the Netherlands follow Britain in voting out of the EU, that will probably be the end of the EU. So what is going on? What on earth is going on? Well, when something seems to be happening all over the world, maybe I thought it could be sunspots, right? I mean, you know, sunspots are, you know, supposed to make us all kind of crazy, right? So I looked it up, I went online and I went to NASA, looked at the recent cycles, and sure enough, there was a giant spike of solar activity right around the terrorist attacks of 2001, for about a year around that. So that was kind of a crazy period on Earth related to activity on the sun. And sure enough, beginning in 2014, there was another major cycle. Now, the good news is that it's supposed to go down over the coming years, but maybe that accounts for our craziness. And as I looked into it, it turns out, this is just amazing, the sun, if you look at it, I mean, the NASA, there's a solar dynamics telescope, the sun actually has an anxious face on it. This is what the sun looks like right now. The sun is worried about us. Okay, now, I'm not actually proposing that it's sunspots. But boy, doesn't it feel like that would be a, you know, reasonable explanation? I think we should probably look on Earth first. And so where should we look? Well, the obvious answer is the economy. That's what most analysts say, right? You read about what's going on with Trump, with Brexit, and most analysts point to globalization and the economic effects. Globalization has made most people richer. There have been winners and losers. The losers, of course, then vote for Brexit and Trump. That's the story that we hear, and there is some truth to it. So this is a graph. It's a very important graph. This is sometimes known as the elephant graph. You see there's a profile of an elephant there? So the elephant graph, it shows if you divide the world population up into 20 different baskets, and you just look what happened to the people in each 20th of the population from 1988 to 2008, did they get richer or what? And what you find is that almost everybody is a lot better off, largely because of globalization, especially in Asia. More than 1 billion people have been lifted well out of poverty because of globalization. But there are two groups that didn't do so well. The bottom 5%, they're only up about 15%. It's not nothing, but not as well as everybody else. And most importantly, the working class in the United States. These are people who used to have factory jobs, low skill but medium wage jobs. And those are the exact jobs that, when they were shipped to Asia, made it possible for 1 billion people in Asia to rise into the middle class. So it's sad, but some people had to lose so that many more could win. And those are the people who are disproportionately likely to vote for Trump and for Brexit. This is the economic explanation, and I think there is some truth to it. But I think it's less than half the story. I think moral psychology is much more powerful. Take a look at this graph. This is data from the British Election Survey a few months before the Brexit vote. And what it shows on the y-axis is the probability of any Brit voting for Brexit. On the x-axis, how much they approve of capital punishment. And what you see when you divide it up by income is that people with low income, the blue line, are more likely to vote for Brexit than people with high income. So that fits the story. But if you notice, those lines are pretty close together. The income effect is not big compared to the giant main effect of attitudes about the death penalty. People who are opposed to the death penalty vote against Brexit. People who support it vote for it. It's a much better predictor than economic factors. So again, we have to bring in moral psychology. We have to look at the origins and effects of passionate intensity. So I'm gonna do that in the rest of my talk, but I'm not just gonna apply psychology to the rest of the world. At the end, I'm gonna turn it around and look at us, look at psychology. And I'll show that we too are full of passionate intensity. And we too must follow, I think, the ancient advice from Buddhism and Hinduism. If you want the truth to stand clear before you, never be for or against. The struggle between for and against is the mind's worst disease. Okay, so let's dig in. Let's see what exactly has been going on in the United States that has led us to this point. I can show you the story of our political dysfunction in three graphs. Here they are. This first graph shows the degree to which the U.S. Congress is polarized. And what that means technically is if you look at all the different Congresses back to around the Civil War era on the left, it starts at 1879, to what extent can you predict every senator's vote, that's in blue, or every House of Representatives, every representative's vote in red? To what extent can you predict their vote if all you know about them is where they are on the left-right spectrum? And if that's driving all the activity, then Congress is very polarized, according to these political scientists. So what you see is that in the decades after the Civil War, the US Congress was very, very polarized. We then have a period in the mid-20th century, that's the dip in the middle, where we have historically low levels of polarization. There's a lot of bipartisanship. If you know where someone is on the left-right spectrum, that doesn't tell you exactly how they voted. There's a lot more going on. But then look what happens. Beginning in the 1980s in particular, the graphs rise up and up and up steadily. Now, I stopped the graph there in 2000 just as we reach the super high levels that we were at after the Civil War. I mean, it couldn't really get any higher, could it? I mean, we couldn't be worse than the decades after the Civil War, could we? But as you all know, the years since 2000 have been steadily up, up, up. Congress just gets more and more polarized. Now, those are the political elites. Political scientists are in full agreement that our political elites have gotten very, very polarized. But some said, well, that's just the elites. You know, Americans are mostly a kind of a moderate centrist kind of people. The people aren't polarized. And that was true until about 10 years ago, 15 years ago. But now it is no longer true. So this is data from the Pew Foundation. when you, they do surveys of attitudes of Americans, and so you, they ask all kinds of attitude questions about environmentalism or gun control or abortion. And so if you just, on the bottom line, you see how far apart men and women are. You just take the absolute value of the difference between men and women on every item, how far apart are they? And the answer is not very far apart. We're not split on our attitudes by gender. And that hasn't changed, low levels continuously from 1987 through 2012 when this data ends. Religion, also pretty low. If you look at income, education, and race, that's more, 10, 12% apart. But notice that they're not rising. So Americans are not coming apart on these demographic factors, except for one. The orange line is party. If you look at how far apart Republicans and Democrats are, even in the late 1990s, they were only about 10 to 12 points apart. And by 2012, they were 18 points apart. And I'll have to see if I can find more recent data. It's going to be even worse, much worse. And when Americans come apart by party, we then think differently about each other. And this, I think, is the most important graph for psychologists, affective polarization. How much do we dislike each other? So the American National Election Survey collects data on American voters every other year. And they use what they call a feeling thermometer. So on a scale of 0 is very cold, to 100 is very warm, you really like them. What do you think about the Supreme Court? Or about Italian Americans? Or baseball? Anything. They don't do baseball, but whatever. They ask about a lot of attitude objects. And what you find when they ask about what you think about the Republican Party or the Democratic Party, on the top lines you see in blue is what Democrats think about the Democratic Party, and the red is what Republicans think about the Republican Party. What you see is that they like their party. Now, I can't wait to get the newest data. I'm sure the Republicans are going to dip quite a lot. But overall, Americans like their own party, and they dislike the other party. But note, the cross-party ratings, they're below 50, but not much. So in the 70s to the 90s, it dips from, you know, 47 down to 40. Okay. So it's dropping, but not much, and they're not that negative. Well, what happens in the Bush and Obama years? Nosedive. And that's actually data from Obama's first term. Again, when I get the data from after this election, it's going to look much, much worse. So, so this is what's happening to us. Now, why? Why are all these changes happening, and why are they intensifying in the last 15 years? That's the question. So I teamed up with a friend of mine, a political scientist, Sam Abrams, and we wrote an article in the Washington Post last year listing what we think are the 10 top reasons. There's more, but these are the 10 clearest reasons why our politics have become so broken. Here are the reasons. I'm not going to go through them all, but I can actually summarize them in this way. These are all changes and trends that have interacted with our tribal nature. So think back. Most of you took an intro psych course or a social psych course. Most of you know about the famous summer camp study by Muzaffar Sharif. He took 11-year-old boys, brought them to a summer camp in Oklahoma. They spontaneously behaved sort of like Lord of the Flies. They did all this tribal stuff. And Sharif was able to ramp up their tribalism and violence, actually, by putting them into closer competition, and he was able to end it by giving them superordinate goals. So you can manipulate tribalism based on external circumstances. And so here's the story. I'm going to oversimplify, but this, I think, is the main thread of modern American political history. So in 1964, President Johnson signs the Civil Rights Act, a momentous moment, a major step forward for the United States. On that day, a young man who was working for him, a young man named Bill Moyers, you may have heard of, comes in to see the president and to congratulate him. "Mr. President, what a great day, what a great victory." And the president is morose. "Mr. President, what's wrong?" And the president says to him, "We've just turned the South over to the Republicans for the rest of my life and yours." So this is, and he was right, and this is what starts the shifting tectonic plates that give us a perfectly conservative party and a perfectly liberal party or progressive party. You can see it here. This is the electoral map from when Jimmy Carter won. Blue is the Democrats, red is the Republicans, and those of you who are young might look at this and say, "Wait, didn't you get those colors backwards? Well, what's going on there?" And this is the last time that a Democrat won the South. The Democratic Party was always a Southern and agrarian party. Note New England and the West Coast. They're Republican, as they had been for more than a century. So this is the electoral map, or this is a version of it, as it used to be. But as those tectonic plates shifted, as conservative Southern Democrats left the Democratic Party, joined the Republican, that made the Republican Party more conservative and the Democratic Party more progressive. So we get a big split, a right-left split. And it goes back and forth, but by the time we get to the 90s, and then by George W. Bush's election, we have the now familiar map, very, very stable, except for a few, you know, 3 to 5 swing states. So this is what's happened. We now have all the people on the left are in one party, all the people on the right are in another party. And once that happened, once we got party realignment and purified parties, then the voters all went into the appropriate party for them. And once the voters in each party were either all on the left or all on the right, that's step number two. Then we get all these other effects interacting with our normal tribal psychology. So Newt Gingrich comes in 1995, institutes a number of changes to ramp up the partisanship. He doesn't want all the new Republican freshman congressmen getting cozy, getting friendly with the Democrats, as they had a tradition of doing. So we get a much more partisan Congress. We get media fractionation. We get cable television in the 1980s, so that now you can just watch confirmation, your politics all the time. And that's nothing compared to the internet in the 1990s. We get residential homogeneity. We get people moving, all the people on the left move into the cities. Not all, but there's a general trend of progressives into the cities and conservatives into the outer suburbs and countryside, et cetera. So all these trends interact, the ones in red, all interact very directly with our partisan nature. This, I think, is what's happened to us. And notice when they all hit. In blue, look at the dates when these trends kind of matured, you might say, or happened. They're almost all in the 1990s. So we have this shift, this purification of the parties that starts in the 60s and 70s. It flowers in the 90s, and the net result is this. The nosedive in what we think of each other, in our rising hostility towards each other in the last 15 years. Now, I assure you, Democrats blame George W. Bush for the rising polarization. Republicans blame Barack Obama. But the truth is that there was a 10-car freight train of polarizing trends crashing down the tracks of our democracy, and neither man could have done anything to stop it. Okay, that line was totally overwritten. I'm sorry, that was like awkward and weird. But you get the idea, right? There are 10 trends. This is not one man's doing. Now, this intense hostility is now spreading throughout our culture. It's tearing us apart in some very disturbing ways. Christian denominations are splitting over the issue of gay marriage and ordination of women and ordination of gay bishops. In our commerce, Starbucks announces that people can no longer bring guns into a Starbucks, even if they have a permit to carry. And so what happens? Well, restaurants that lean right say, hey, if you bring a gun, you get a discount. Just aim carefully, please. And it's not just whether you carry a gun or not. Now, it's even what you think about gun control. So I just found this story last week. A woman in Maine who runs two restaurants, she was so upset about the Orlando shootings. So she put up a Facebook post that said, if you own this gun, or you condone the ownership of this gun. If you don't side with me on gun control, you're not allowed in my restaurant. The road to democratic hell is paved with partisan intentions. This is where we are. Now, why do people care? Why are people so passionate? Most of the laws we're passionate about are symbolic issues. They're rarely going to even affect our lives directly. So what is going on? So we need to look a little more closely at the psychology of tribalism, of morality, of passionate intensity. This is the hardcover version of my book, The Righteous Mind. And a book cover is supposed to convey a feeling, what the book is about. And so I think the designer here did a very good job. In the UK, it's a different publisher, different art department. They found a very different way of conveying moral psychology. I quite enjoy that. Though I'm very glad it's not the American cover, but okay. And then this is the cover of the paperback in the United States, and I think it really conveys again the idea of demonization. Now, the book is three ideas. There are three principles. And if you understand these three principles, you understand moral psychology. So intuitions come first, strategic reasoning second. You all know this. Motivated reasoning, rationalization. We are so good at finding reasons for whatever we want to believe or whatever our side believes. This is why you can't argue someone out of their moral or political positions. Second, as Susan mentioned in my research with my colleague, we found that there are at least six intuitive foundations like taste buds of the moral sense. Everybody has them all, but the left tends to build more on care and fairness as a quality. The right builds more than the left does on issues of loyalty, sanctity, and authority. But it's the third one that I want to focus on today, because this is the one that helps us understand our present sorry state. Morality binds and blinds. So here's the way to think about it. On our planet, large-scale cooperation is very, very rare. So the bees are able to get together and build gigantic beehives. The termites, little tiny, tiny termites, can build this 20-foot-tall termite mound. It's quite amazing. There's a trick. What evolution has found, or invented accidentally, is that if all of them are children of the same queen, and then they're sterile, so that they're all in the same boat genetically, well, then actually, it just works out that you can get massive cooperation. So when you find large structures on this planet, they're always built by siblings. There's only one exception, humans. Humans, we're really, really good at building large structures. This is a reconstruction of Babylon. This is Tenochtitlan. Civilization broke out on this planet in many places. You always find temples first. You don't get people developing civilization without temples. The reason, I believe, is because we developed this neat trick. We have this psychology of sacredness. These are Muslims circling the Kaaba, a holy stone, holy rock in Mecca. We have this ability to circle around something. We all worship it together, and that binds us together into one. A community. We trust each other. We can work together. We can fight against other groups. The metaphor that I used to think about this myself is from high school physics. You remember if you move a wire through a magnetic field, that generates electricity. It moves the electrons. That's how you generate electricity. Emil Durkheim, the sociologist, used this metaphor. He said that ritual generates social electricity. When we worship something together, a current goes through us. We're charged, we're energized, we're a group. It doesn't have to be a god. Anything we circle around, we treat as sacred and holy. We defend together. We can then trust each other and fight as a group. But when we do this, when we generate this electricity, we generate a polarity. We generate an electromagnet, we charge up an electromagnet. Our side is perfectly good. The other side is perfectly evil. And this, I believe, is why many Bernie supporters are having a lot of trouble switching over to Hillary, because they spent a year in this electromagnet, a year talking about why Bernie was so great and Hillary was so evil. And then, in the course of just a couple days, they're asked to completely reverse polarity. Now Hillary's supposed to be all good, and Trump is supposed to be all bad. It's very difficult. It'll take a while. Most of them will get there, although a few may not. So this, I think, is what's going on. This, I think, is a useful metaphor for our politics. We're all living in these powerful electromagnetic fields. I actually want to do a little test of that, of what is the field that we psychologists are in. So let me ask you guys a question. How many of you, from the time you woke up this morning till right now, have engaged in at least one conversation where it was clear that the other person dislikes Donald Trump and is opposed to or will vote against Donald Trump? From the time you woke up all the way through what you did here in Denver, raise your hand high if you've had at least one conversation where you knew the other person is against Trump. Okay. All right, a lot of you, not quite half, but a lot. Okay, how many of you today have had at least one conversation where it was clear that the other person didn't like Hillary Clinton, Hillary Clinton's bad, we're gonna vote against Hillary? One, two, three, four, about nine. 9 or 10, okay? I don't know how many are in this room, 700 or 800 probably. So this is the field that we psychologists are in. This is the field that academics are in. This is the field that people in advertising, the creative industries are in. The left and the right live in different worlds now. We live in different magnetic fields. Okay, let's keep going. Suppose you met someone here at this conference who was wearing a Trump button. How would you feel? Would you feel some sort of flash of negativity towards that person? Raise your hand high if you would feel at least some sort of flash of negativity. Okay, now it's the majority. Okay, a large majority. Okay. Okay, and how about a Hillary button? If you saw someone with a Hillary button, would you feel hostility? Raise your hand high if you would feel hostility. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. Okay, seven. So this is clearly the field that we psychologists are in. Okay, and now I'm going to ask you another question. You don't have to raise your hand. Well, raise your hand for this. How many of you here in this room are teachers or professors or clinicians or therapists in any way, shape, or form? Raise your hand high. Okay, the great majority. Okay, so most of us here have either clients or patients or students. Now, just think to yourself, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand. If someone comes to see you, a client, a patient, a student, and it comes out in conversation that they're voting for Trump, how many of you are confident that you could treat that person without bias, that you could be as careful, as professional, as helpful to that person as if they were voting for Hillary? Don't raise your hand, just think about it. Because I know that most of you think you could do it, but I also know that most of you couldn't. Think about all that we talk about implicit bias. If you think implicit bias matters for race, well, this is much more passionate than race. So I think we have a problem. I think psychology, like most fields in America, has a problem. Now, I've been trying to actually encourage more political diversity in psychology. We desperately need it, and I'll say why at the end. But this election is going to make it a lot harder. America is polarizing, psychology is polarizing. Hostility towards conservatives within psychology is growing, as it is in so many other parts of American life. So let me offer to you a distinction that I think is incredibly helpful, and it might help to tone down some of the hostility towards conservatives. There's a fantastic distinction. This is an amazing book. This is the book for our times. The Authoritarian Dynamic by political scientist Karen Stenner, written in 2004. Or 2005, rather. And she offers us, from her own research on authoritarianism, she finds that there are three different, psychologically different groups of people who vote for the Republican Party or vote for the right. Authoritarians are very, very different from laissez-faire conservatives and from status quo conservatives. Let me just run through those. Laissez-faire conservatives, she says, are people who have a persistent preference for a free market and limited government intervention in the economy. Well, we used to call these people liberals. That's what liberal meant for 100 years, classical liberals. So people like Milton Friedman, there's nothing conservative about him, nothing conservative about these people. So we shouldn't call them conservatives. They really, actually, in Europe, they're called liberals. But this is one group that votes, has traditionally voted Republican, because they don't like the statism, the big government programs of the Democrats. The second group, and these are really the classical, these are really the heart of the real conservatives, you might say. These are people who have an enduring inclination to favor stability and preservation of the status quo over social change. Best exemplified by the Irish philosopher Edmund Burke, his reflections on the revolution in France, and this is before it got really violent. He observed, what happens when you tear down all of the institutions and structures? It can't be good. And sure enough, years after his book came out, things got really awful in the French Revolution. This is the conservatism of George W. Bush, George H.W. Bush. Those of you who are as old as I will remember Dana Carvey's impersonations of him on Saturday Night Live. You remember? Not gonna do it. And why not gonna do it? Wouldn't be prudent. Okay, so that's status quo conservative. Whoa, slow down. Caution, don't go ripping everything up. Let's take this one step at a time. And incidentally, this is the kind of thinking that you find in one of my favorite magazines, National Review. I urge you to read it if you want really thoughtful commentary from the right, from the status quo conservative perspective. It's a wonderful place to broaden, to get new ideas. And note, they really hate Donald Trump. because he's not a conservative. He is not in favor of the status quo. He is in favor of radical change. So what then is Trump? Well, Trump, according to Stenner, is an authoritarian. These are people who demonstrate a triad of racial, political, and moral intolerance, the tendency to glorify some in-group and denigrate out-groups, to venerate a set of ideas and practices, and to reward or punish others according to their conformity to this normative order. Now, I've put a picture of Benito Mussolini up here because he is the classic authoritarian. He ran fascist Italy in that way. But let me be very, very clear that Trump is not a fascist. It's over-polarizing to use the word fascist. It's not correct. Fascism is a collectivist ideology, a very particular ideology of the people and the state. Trump is more of an individualist. So historians, experts on fascism say Trump is not a fascist. We should not use that word. It's much more accurate. Trump is an authoritarian, I'm saying, but he's not a fascist. It's much more accurate to compare him to Berlusconi. As a president, he would be much more like Silvio Berlusconi, or perhaps like Berlusconi's buddy, Vladimir Putin. Or perhaps like what's happening in Poland with Jaroslaw Kaczynski, or in Hungary with Viktor Orban. So we're seeing the rise of right-wing leaders who are populists and who behave, as Stenner described, with this authoritarian outlook, focusing on protecting the in-group, kicking out immigrants, deviants, moral deviants, that sort of thing. This is, I believe, what is happening. Now, I know it's very common to refer to Trump as an authoritarian, and I'm careful about saying such things unless there's good evidence. I've collected some. So I teamed up with a political scientist, Emily Eakins, and we published a paper in Vox a few months ago. And what we did was Emily used my Moral Foundations questionnaire, gave it to a nationally representative sample of voters in the primaries in November. And then we were able to see, based on their Moral Foundations scores, can those help us predict which candidate they like in both of the primaries? And just to cut to the chase, here's the finding. Even when you partial out, in a regression analysis, when you control for gender, age, education, and where they are on left-right, on the left-right scale, control for all that stuff, people who say that Trump is their man are particularly low on care and compassion. They're kind of more cold. And they're particularly high on authority, loyalty, and sanctity. And so this is exactly the authoritarian profile that Stenner told us about. So I am confident in saying that Trump is an authoritarian in terms of his personality and in terms of the appeal that he has. Now, let me tell you a bit more about authoritarianism because it's vital to understand what's happening here and in Europe. Stenner tells us that authoritarianism is not a stable personality trait. It's rather a response to certain conditions, to the perception of normative threat, a threat to the moral order. So think about it like, some people have a kind of a, like an alarm button on their forehead, and when that button is pushed, then they become authoritarian. And Stenner tells us that the three main kinds of normative threat are disobedience to group authorities or authorities unworthy of respect. And here she actually refers to Bill Clinton's sexual dalliance and behavior in the White House, degrading the White House. So while she herself is on the left, she does point the finger at both sides. Second, nonconformity to group norms. And third, lack of consensus in group values and beliefs, diversity run amok. When people perceive these things, if they have the predisposition, then they become authoritarian. This is exactly what Richard Nixon did in 1968. It was a year of chaos. We've heard many comparisons of 2016 to 1968. It was a year of chaos and crime and violence and political violence. And so Richard Nixon runs as the law and order candidate, doing everything he can to push that authoritarian button, and it works. Now, the amazing thing is that Donald Trump's campaign manager actually said in an interview a few days before the Republican convention, he said, yeah, we're gonna model Trump's acceptance speech on Richard Nixon's 1968 acceptance speech. It's a very deliberate strategy to push the authoritarian button. That is what Trump is doing. So what is the response? Well, so for example, here's a quote from his talk. The crime and violence will soon end. So he's promising to clean it up. So again, this is the authoritarian approach. Now, if this is what's happening, then I think that leads to some advice about what could be done to stop it. And here, I must recognize I'm on very thin ice here, because in my own field, in social psychology, it's common for people to make jokes about how stupid and evil Republicans and conservatives are. And I have tried to tell people in my field, stop doing that. You're creating a hostile climate. Don't do that. And so I recognize that. And there are surely some people who are voting for Trump here. I would guess from the hands that we've seen, probably about 9. but I'm sorry, I don't mean to make a joke. I mean, and the people who are voting for Trump here surely face a very hostile climate. And we actually really need them. We need political diversity. They are members of our community. We all have to try to not make a hostile climate. And so I don't want to make them feel unwelcome. I don't want to criticize them. Nowadays in America, we vote mostly against a candidate rather than for. And so I fully recognize and understand the reasons why many Americans will vote against Hillary Clinton. So I want to acknowledge that. I'm not saying they're bad and evil and we need to change them. But this is happening all over the West. Clearly, Western democracies are doing something that's alienating and embittering a lot of their citizens. They're making huge policy mistakes, and I think they need to change. And I think Stenner has advice about what that is. And here it is. Stenner says, we can best limit intolerance of difference by parading, talking about, and applauding our sameness. Ultimately, nothing inspires greater tolerance from the intolerant than an abundance of common and unifying beliefs, practices, rituals, institutions, and processes. And regrettably, nothing is more certain to provoke increased expression of their latent predispositions than the likes of multicultural education, bilingual policies, and non-assimilation. Guess who took their advice? Guess who took Stenner's advice? The Democrats. They have been doing this brilliantly. The Democratic National Convention was a brilliant instantiation of Stenner's advice. So many of the speakers displayed an abundance of common and unifying beliefs, practices, rituals, institutions. The peak, the pinnacle, the emotional pinnacle for many people, of course, was the speech by Kaiser Khan, where he says, we are honored to stand here as parents of Captain Humayun Khan and as patriotic American Muslims with undivided loyalty for our country. So it's talk like this that turns off the button. And it's not just propaganda that you wheel out at election time. It's actually, I think, and Stenner thinks, really, really good advice for multicultural societies to focus not on multiculturalism, but on unifying and assimilation. That, at least, is the advice that Stenner, and I think it's good advice, gives to Europeans and to America. Now, what I'm saying then, to conclude this part of the talk, is that authoritarianism is a problem for democracies, as we're seeing in Poland and Hungary, for example. But conservatism is not a problem for democracies at all. In fact, it's an essential element. You need a conservative party. Every country needs an effective center-right party. As John Stuart Mill said, a party of order or stability and a party of progress or reform are both necessary elements of a healthy state of political life. So in the final part of the talk, I want to now apply all of this to us. Let's look in the mirror. Are we ready to help solve this problem? Are we ready to go out and study and figure out how to turn around polarization? I don't think so. Do we have yin-yang going on here? Do we have viewpoint diversity? Do we know that the things that we recommend are recommended because the evidence supports them? Or is it often the case that the ideas that we circle around, the ideas that we love and promote and talk about, are the ones that are politically pleasing? We have a lot of sacred values in psychology, especially around matters of race, gender, equality, immigration, and many other topics. We lean very far left, like almost all academic fields and like many other parts of the country. Here's some evidence of that. This is data, representative surveys of American professors, and what this shows, the top line, is professors who said that they were left of center. The red line is professors who say they're right of center or conservative. As recently as 1995, the ratio of left to right in the academy was 2-1. And that's fine. We don't need equality. What we need is the confidence that if someone says something that basically is just politically correct, pleasing stuff that the evidence doesn't support, someone else is going to say, excuse me, here's a contrary argument. As long as we can count on that, we're good. But from the mid-90s to 2010, the conservatives dropped out, the left shot up. We now have a 5-1 ratio. But most of the conservatives are in engineering schools, dental schools. In the core areas of the university, the humanities and social sciences, it's between 10-1 and 40-1. Almost as lopsided as this room. So, and psychology is the same. So we are purifying. We are losing our diversity. Rich Redding wrote a wonderful article in The American Psychologist in 2001, pointing out all the bad things that happen to psychology when we become partisan, all the ways we can't serve our clients and our students, all the ways our research suffers. But since then, of course, things have gotten worse. So last year, I wrote an article with some of my colleagues about social psychology and the problems we have in social psychology because of our bias. We noted that psychology, again, as recently as the early 1990s, we were only 2 or 3-1 left to right. But now we're closer to 10 or 15-1 in the academic sphere. We noted how the lack of diversity undermines many of our research, especially on politicized topics. We explained how increased diversity would improve our science, and we pointed out that there's good evidence now that the imbalance comes from self-selection, certainly. People on the left are more interested in psychology, understandable. But it also comes from hostile climate and discrimination. So let me just show you this. Once I started talking about this, I started getting emails from conservative students, and they reminded me of things I used to read about gay people who were forced to be in the closet in the 1980s when I was in college. So I Googled coming out narratives, and I found this narrative from it was actually a graduate student, I don't know what field, in 1985. She said, "Until about a year ago, I was very quiet about my sexual orientation. I often didn't understand the sexual jokes made by my colleagues. The people making the jokes thought that we all felt the same way, and I certainly wasn't going to reveal that I disagreed. That would have been too awkward." And then she talks about one professor who seemed to be more open, more tolerant, more welcoming, and how important it was for her to have a relationship with this professor, and how she came to trust, and how she came to open up, and was gradually confident enough to actually speak and to feel that she needs to speak. And when I found this, I was just amazed, because this story from 1985 is so similar to a letter, an email that I got from a conservative student in 2011. It was actually a grad student in psychology, and she wrote to me. She said, "Until about a year ago, I was very quiet about my political opinions. I often didn't understand the political jokes made by my colleagues. The people making the jokes thought, et cetera, et cetera." Now, what a coincidence, huh? These two letters are really, really similar, because obviously this is the letter that I got in 2011, and when I read it, I thought, wow, what if I change 5 words? What if I just change those words in red to that? And so my point is, people who are not on the left, and this is actually true about moderates too, to some extent, people who are not on the left are often in the closet. They can't speak up, they can't criticize, they hear somebody say something, they believe it's false, but they can't speak up and say why they think it's false. And that is a breakdown of our science. I'll skip this in the interest of time. The point is just that one study by Inbar and Lammers did a more comprehensive survey, and they found, sure enough, there is a lot of overt discrimination against conservatives in social psychology. So I think that we are part of the problem, not yet part of the solution. Can we change? If we are politically polarized, can we change? Can we depoliticize and depolarize ourselves so that we can devote our prodigious skills to working on the problem? I don't know, but I think that we must try. So in this very final section of the talk, I just want to lay out what I think is an action agenda for psychology. We must become the change we seek. Can we depolarize and depoliticize psychology? Here's how we might do it. First, I think we have to start with ourselves. We have to get our hearts in order. We have to get ready to actually accept that this is a problem. As Susan mentioned, my first book, The Happiness Hypothesis, was a collection of ancient wisdom, ancient psychological insights. And one of the greatest psychological insights discovered by wise people in every major culture are that we are moralistic hypocrites, and they all advise us to be more humble and less judgmental. Obviously, the Sermon on the Mount, and of course, so much of Hinduism and Buddhism has urged on us these changes. Second, we have to get our field in order. And I think we must increase and welcome more viewpoint diversity. John Stuart Mill, a wonderful quote, he says, in almost every one of the leading controversies, both sides were in the right in what they affirmed, though in the wrong in what they denied. And if either could have been made to take the other's views in addition to its own, little more would have been needed to make its doctrine correct. I've been very privileged to moderate a group of poverty experts on the left and the right. We wrote this report, it came out about 6 months ago. It was unbelievable how the left is always talking about economic and structural causes, and they're right. The right's always talking about more close to home, social and moral causes, the decline of the family and marriage, and they're right. And both sides kind of argued and tried to reject the other side, but ultimately became clear, they're both right, and you need to look at both if you really care about poverty. I think this is a great model for us to do social science on politicized topics. That's why I've started, as Susan mentioned, Heterodox Academy. If you're a professor interested in supporting viewpoint diversity, I urge you to check it out. Another part of getting our field in order is we need to go easier on each other. We've just been through a very, very rough patch. I really don't envy you taking the reins at this point, but it seems that you're guiding us through it and to where we need to go. People are understandably angry. We have a lot of divisions in psychology. I mean, a lot of splits, a lot of hostility, as well as a lot of friendship and goodwill, of course. But we need to tone it down. We need to become more forgiving. And if we want to try to change things, we need to do it much more from the perspective of love than the perspective of hate. This was Buddha's counsel. If you actually want to change things, he said, look how he abused me and beat me, how he threw me down and robbed me. If you live with such thoughts, you live in hate. Look how he abused me and beat me, how he threw me down and robbed me. Abandon such thoughts and live in love. In this world, hate never yet dispelled hate. Only love dispels hate. This is the law, ancient and inexhaustible. So yes, work for change. But doing it in an angry, vindictive way tends to backfire. We, especially within our family of psychologists, need to try to give each other more of the benefit of the doubt and do it in a more positive and collegial way. So finally, if we can do all of that, then I think we would be ready to tackle the problem that is bedeviling Western democracies. We could launch an APA initiative on polarization and democracy. We could study all these trends. Now, we can't do these ourselves. A lot of these are beyond psychology, but they can't do it without us. These all involve psychology. So, what's the cause of our problems? Is it sunspots? Probably not. I think it's us. It's normal human moral psychology. And so, as I said at the beginning, we've come together at a confusing and an alarming time. And it is therefore of great comfort that others have been here before us and left us some guidance. So I close with the famous and beautiful words that Abe Lincoln spoke in his first inaugural after several states had already seceded and the Civil War was looming. We are not enemies, but friends. We must not be enemies. Though passion may have strained, it must not break the bonds of our affection. The mystic chords of memory will swell when again touched, as surely they will be by the better angels of our nature. Thank you.
Great, thank you so much.